Good morning. Good morning. It's good to see you this morning, church. Why don't you stand? It's good to be in the Lord's house this morning. Come thou fount of every blessing. We want the Lord's presence in this place. He inhabits our praise, so we got to do our part. Let's sing it together. Lift your voice and sing.
Come thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing thy grace, streams of mercy never ceasing. Call for song the loudest praise. Teach me song that on his sonnet, sung by many times above. Praise the name I'm fixed upon it, name of God's redeeming love. Hither though thy love has blessed me, thou hast brought
give the Lord praise this morning. Amen. Just remain standing if you would. Here's a great new song called The Lord's Prayer, and Alton is going to start it for us. Can you put your hands together like this? Come on. Got to slow down. Don't clap too fast. Right there. There you go. We'll get it. Sing this with us.
Father, let your kingdom come.
There you go.
Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Oh, Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us as we forgive the ones who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the one. Let your kingdom come.
The power, the glory are yours.
great singing. You can be seated.
Amen. What a joy to come together and to gather saying, hey, we want to say the words that Jesus said. We want to declare that we want your kingdom to come, your will to be done in our lives. And as we begin our worship, I can't think of a better way to do that. It's a joy to be together. And I want to wish a happy Mother's Day to the mothers in the room. Thank you so much for gathering this morning. Our pastor is going to lead us in a time of blessing, a special moment for our moms later in the service. But I don't want to step up here without saying thank you to our moms. A happy Mother's Day to you. And if you're a guest with us, we're so grateful to have you here with us. We pray that you experience the Lord's presence, that you walk out of here saying, the Lord is working in my life, and that you walk out of here connected to someone. Pastor and I would love to meet you personally after the service. We'll be out there in the foyer, and we have a gift for you, but we would love to get to know you and help you get connected here at First Baptist. We're looking forward to a wonderful time of worship today. We're excited about what the Lord wants to do in us this morning, and part of our time together, a key part of our worship, is that we would go to the Lord together in prayer. I'm going to ask you to join me in that as our ushers come forward to take an offering. Let's pray and seek the Lord together. Lord, I thank you that you're kind and faithful, that you're at work in us. I thank you for our moms, for mothers who serve and love and protect and cherish in all kinds of different situations, Lord. And I pray that you'd pour out your grace on them today, that they would experience a special blessing and encouragement from their families and from those around them. Lord, most of all, we're here to say that you are the Lord, that we want you to be glorified and honored, that we want you to be worshiped with all of our hearts, Lord. And so as we gather this morning, we ask that you would guide us and that you would lead us and that you would fill us with your Spirit. Lord, we pray for our pastor as he prepares to preach your word. Lord, as we gather under the authority of what you have said, Lord, we pray that you'd use it to change us and that we'd walk out of here seeking to walk out obedience in our lives, Lord. And as we give a portion of what you've graciously given to us, we pray that you'd use these tithes and offerings for your glory, that you would accomplish your work both here in our county and all over the world. And we say that we love you, and it's in your name we ask these things. Amen.
We're going to share a new song with you today. It's the song we'll sing in heaven. Holy, 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 he's holy forever. It's a great new song we want you to learn this morning.
A thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above the throne. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above the fall, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever.
Just sing with us on the verse.
Forgiven and shall your name stand above of all.
Sing again.
Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stand above of all thrones and dominions, all powers and possessions.
Presence, let's sing together.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned of me.
Sing it out.
How marvelous, how wonderful.
as Gary plays for another second, and just take a minute and thank the Lord. Just something specific this morning. How good he has been to you. The blessings that we do not deserve. His love is active. The Bible says that God demonstrated his love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Lord, we thank you for your love today. And may what we're living for, Lord, be worth what you died for. Thank you for your great love for us, and we declare our love for you this morning. In Jesus' name, we all said amen. You can be seated. This is a wonderful new anthem, a very appropriate song on Mother's Day. So we wish you happy Mother's Day, moms in the room. And this is a prayer, a blessing over you and your families.
Oh.
His favors be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and your children, and your children. And His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May His presence come before you and behind you and beside you, all around you.
Thank you so much, choir and orchestra, and thank you for being here. I know you enjoyed Pastor Rayleigh. He did such a good job, I had to come back and protect my turf. He was going to take over. Before I start the message, I do want to take a moment and say Happy Mother's Day to all of you ladies. I'm always aware on this day that there are a couple of groups of people for whom this is a very hard day. One are the ladies who are trying to be a mom. They want to have a baby, and that hasn't happened for them yet. That's the case in the passage we're going to read in a moment in Scripture. Some of you were there, and you know the difficulty of that. And I pray for you especially that God would give you the desire of your heart, and whether that is through a biological birth or the wonderful gift of adoption or whatever, however God chooses to do that, that God would grant you favor in that area. The other that always comes to mind are those that have recently lost their mother in this life. That's always difficult. She was the first one to hold you, the first one to kiss you, the first one to really love you with her whole heart. She's been everything to you, and that first Mother's Day when she's gone is often very difficult, and I pray for those of you for whom that is the case. Now, if your mother is still living, you call her today or go see her if you can. I had many, many years where my mother did not know who I was, but I knew who she was. So I would go and see her, not because it was something that she needed, but it was something that I needed. So you tell your mother that you love her. If your mother, like mine, is no longer with you, take a moment today and just reflect and remember. And thank the Lord for the wonderful person that God put in your life that you called mom, and the joy that she was to you. I'd like to just pray for all the ladies. If you are a mom, a grandmom, would you stand for a moment? Let us recognize you and remain standing. I'm going to lead a prayer for you. Well, ladies, congratulations on Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to all of you. Let me pray for you right now. Father, I do pray for these ladies. I pray that you would bless them. They have such a load to carry in life because they are a mom and a grandmom. They have so many jobs to do. Thank you, Lord, for the blessing that they are to so many. Thank you for the difference that they make in this community. Thank you for the difference that they make in this church. And I pray that you would grant every one of them today an awareness of your presence, your power, that your favor, just as the choir just sang, that your favor would be upon them, that you would go before them and be in them and go with them in all that they do. Thank you for this day, what it represents. Now we open your word and we ask you to speak to our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, ladies. You may be seated. As you might expect, I'm going to pause in our study in Luke. We would be in a passage today that deals with the end of time and how things are going to happen in the last days. We'll pick that up next week. We'll be right back to it. But today we're going to look at a passage in 1 Samuel. So if you'll turn that in the Old Testament, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1 Samuel, toward the first part of the Bible. Find 1 Samuel chapter 1, and I'm going to read from this passage in just a moment. Now, we have a lot of superheroes in our culture, right? We've got Batman and Superman and Spider-Man and the X-Men and Thor and all of those superheroes, but they're all fictional. They're comic book characters and movie characters, and as fun as that is, it's just fiction. But moms are real superheroes. You think about all the things that a mom does, a typical mom. I mean, she's coach, she's teacher, she's cook, she's referee, she's cop, she's psychiatrist and psychologist, she's doctor and nurse. She is cook. She is, in some cases, maid. She is Uber driver. And she does all of that before breakfast. She is truly a superhero. Now, this passage that I'm going to read is about a mom. It was a woman who wanted to be a mom, and she was having trouble having that happen in her life. And she went to the Lord, and the Lord blessed her. And there are really three things. As I'll read the passage, and it's a familiar passage to you, I'm going to read the passage. I'm going to point out three biblical truths just from the text. And then I want to give you seven principles today. These are the so whats. When I finish with the three points of the text, I'm going to give you some so whats that are the takeaways on this Mother's Day that I trust will be biblical principles right from God's Word that will help us to have Christian homes and Christian families. I want to begin reading in 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 1, and we're just going to read the first part of this familiar story. It says, "There was a man from Ramathaim Zophim in the hill country of Ephraim. His name was Elkanah, the son of Jeroam, the son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, the son of Zuph, an Ephraimite. He had two wives. The first named Hannah, the second Peninnah. Peninnah had children, but Hannah was childless. This man would go up from his town every year to worship and to sacrifice to the Lord of hosts at Shiloh, where Eli's two sons, Hophni and Phinehas, were the Lord's priest. Whenever Elkanah offered a sacrifice, he always gave portions of the meat to his wife Peninnah and to each of her sons and daughters. But he gave a double portion to Hannah, for he loved her even though the Lord had kept her from conceiving. Her rival would taunt her severely just to provoke her, because the Lord had kept Hannah from conceiving. Whenever she went up to the Lord's house, her taunting, her rival taunted her in this way every year. Hannah wept and would not eat. "Hannah, why are you crying?" her husband Elkanah asked. "Why won't you eat? Why are you troubled? Am I not better to you than 10 sons?" Hannah got up after they ate and drank at Shiloh. Eli the priest was sitting on a chair by the doorpost of the Lord's tabernacle. Deeply hurt, Hannah prayed to the Lord and wept with many tears. Making a vow, she pleaded, "Lord of hosts, if you will take notice of your servant's affliction, remember and not forget me, and give your servant a son, I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life. His hair will never be cut." While she continued praying in the Lord's presence, Eli watched her lips. Hannah was praying silently, and though her lips were moving, her voice could not be heard. Eli thought she was drunk and scolded her. "How long are you going to be drunk? Get rid of your wine." "No, my Lord," Hannah replied. "I'm a woman with a broken heart. I haven't had any wine or beer. I've been pouring out my heart before the Lord. Don't think of me as a wicked woman. I've been praying from the depths of my anguish and resentment." Eli responded, "Go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant the petition you've requested from him." "May your servant find favor with you," she replied. Then Hannah went on her way. She ate, and she no longer looked despondent. Now, you know the rest of the story, don't you? You know that God did grant her favor. You know that God did give her that child. Now, I want to show you three things, point out three things to you from the text. Let's just look at it textually to start with. That's really the heart of any message. What does God's word say? What does God's word teach us? There are three things I want to point out to you. This is not the only thing in the passage I just read, but three things that I think are pretty obvious. Here's the first one. Hannah and Elkanah loved each other. Now, that's really where family starts, right? That's really what marriage is all about. It's a man and a woman. It's a man and a woman. That's what Scripture says. It's a man and a woman who come together in a relationship that God puts within their heart because they love each other. And you see it in this passage. When you look down in verse 5, for example, it said, "But he gave a double portion to Hannah, for he loved her, even though the Lord had kept her from conceiving." When you look in verse 8, "Hannah, why are you crying?" her husband Elkanah asked. "Why won't you eat? Why are you troubled? Am I not better to you than 10 sons?" In other words, don't be so distraught. Don't be so upset about this, Hannah. We have each other, and we love each other. When Joy and I got married in 1978, we were married for 5 years before we had our first child. I'm glad it worked out that way. We wanted to have children earlier, sooner than that, but that's the way that in God's providence it happened. But you know what came out of that? We learned early on in marriage that we like each other. We learned before we had children that we're going to be okay when the children are grown up and gone and when the house is empty. We're going to be okay because we like each other. Did you know that one of the greatest gifts you can give to your children is an awareness that you love each other? And that when you love each other, that's going to be infected into their lives and the way they see things, their outlook on life, their outlook on marriage. One of the greatest gifts we can give to our children is to give them the stability of knowing that their parents love each other. We're not together just for the sake of the children. We're not together just because of financial expediency and it's more economically smart for us to be together. We need each other in that way. We're together because we love each other. And one day the children are going to be gone. One day the house is going to be empty again and it's just going to be us. And that love for each other, that commitment to each other is going to continue to allow life to be sweet and precious and special for all of the days that God gives to us. Now, it's wonderful to have the children in the house, but one day the children are gone, and all we have is each other. Hannah and Elkanah loved each other. Second thing, though, that comes out of this passage, and you see it again very clearly, is that Hannah and Elkanah loved their, I'm going to say son, let's talk about Samuel, their son, but you can say children. They loved their children. When you read down through the passage, you see that several places. Verse 4, for example, Whenever Elkanah offered a sacrifice, he gave portions of the meat to his wife Peninnah and to each of her sons and daughters. So he loved those children as well. When you look down in verse 26, I didn't read this verse, but when you look at it, "Please, my Lord," she said, "as sure as you live, my Lord, I'm the woman who stood here beside you praying to the Lord. I prayed for this boy, and since the Lord gave me what I asked, I now give the boy to the Lord. For as long as he lives, he is given to the Lord." Then he bowed to worship the Lord there. He loved his child. And if you read a little further, I won't go through all of this story, but if you go a little further over into chapter 2, you learn that Samuel was not the only child that God gave to Hannah and Elkanah. There were 3 sons and 2 daughters, and they loved all of their children. You know one of the things that it means to love your children? It means that you teach your children that God has a special plan for them. It means that you want them to know God's plan for their life. Over in Proverbs, there's a passage that you've read and quoted and heard many, many times. It's Proverbs 22, verse 6. It says, "Teach a youth," I learned it, "train up a child in the way that he should go. And even when he is old, he will not depart from it." What does that mean? What does it mean to train up a child in the way that he should go? When you love a child, when you love your children, and you want to do what God's word says and train them up in the way that they should go, what does that mean? Well, literally, the passage in Proverbs 22 means toward the bent of life, or the purpose of life that God has for each of them, because God created all of us uniquely. And to help a child understand their God-given talent, their God-given ability. Some children think like engineers. Some children think more artistically. Some children think like mathematicians. Children respond differently. Some children are emotional. Some children are more cerebral in the way that they think. Children are all different. Train up a child in the way that they should go, in the way that God created them, in their own bent in life. Help them to understand that God has a plan for their life, and that God's plan for their life is better than anything that they could come up with on their own. It's almost as though that God gives us about an 18-year, and really it's more than that, to be honest. But it's almost like God gives us an 18-year homework assignment as parents. And our assignment is to train up a child in the way that they should go, to help them understand the path that God has for them so that they can live out in fullness what God has for each of them. Train up a child in the way that each of them individually should go. And when they are old, they'll not depart from it. Why would you do that? Because you love them. You love them. You love your children. Your children are all unique, and so you want them to realize God's best for their life. Hannah and Elkanah loved each other. Hannah and Elkanah loved their children. Here's the third thing. Hannah and Elkanah loved the Lord. Now go back to the passage again. Look in verse 3. This is 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 3. This man, talking about Elkanah, this man would go up from his town every year to worship and sacrifice to the Lord of hosts at Shiloh, where Eli's 2 sons, Hophni and Phinehas, were the Lord's priests. Now some of you might be sitting there thinking, well, sign me up for that once a year. Oh yeah, give me the once a year plan. I'm for that. You don't misunderstand the passage. They worshiped every week. They worshiped routinely. They worshiped regularly. Worship was a part of who they were and what they did. But once a year, they would make a special journey. It was a 2 or a 3 week journey. We're not just talking about going to church in the morning at 11 o'clock and being home for kickoff at, 12:30. We're talking about a 2 or a 3 week journey. And every year they did that. They worshiped all of the time. They worshiped throughout the year. But they had this special time that was set apart. Why did they do that? Why did Elkanah go to all of that trouble and expense and time and commitment to make a 2 or a 3 week journey to this special place called Shiloh to worship every single year? Why did he do that? Because they loved the Lord. And they wanted the Lord to be a part of who they were and what they were doing and how they were raising their children. He was serious about this. They loved each other and they loved their children and they loved the Lord and they wanted the Lord to rule over their home. Now, there's a sideline in this that I don't have really time to pursue, but I am going to mention it. There's a secondary story that is at work here about Eli. Now, Eli was the priest at Shiloh, and he had two sons. And those sons were not good people. As a matter of fact, when you get a little bit further over in the passage, it says that they were wicked. Over in chapter 2, verse 12, it says, Eli's sons were wicked men. They had no regard for the Lord. So it's an interesting thing here, isn't it, that you've got Eli, who is a man of God, and it's never laid at his feet, by the way. That's important to know. It's never laid at his feet that his children went a different direction. He raised them right. He taught them right. He gave them every opportunity, but they chose wrong. Everyone is responsible for their own decisions. You may have children that you raised right. It's interesting, isn't it, that out of all of the children that we see in the scriptures, some that are raised in the same home by the same parents in the same way, and some go in the way of the Lord and some go in a different path, that's never laid at the feet of the parents. When you've done your best, when you've really sought the Lord, when you've really determined to live out your faith before your children, everybody's responsible for their own decisions. It was never laid at Eli's feet, but his sons went a different direction, and it must have truly broken his heart as you read through this passage. The reality is that everybody that's exposed to the flu doesn't get it, do they? And everybody that's exposed to faith doesn't get it. You point your children to the Lord. You tell your children about the Lord. You live out a life of faith before your children. You love them with all of your heart, but ultimately they're responsible for their own decisions. That's just a secondary story in the passage. Now, those really are the three, that's the text. Hannah and Elkanah loved each other, they loved their children, and they loved the Lord. It's a clear teaching in the passage, isn't it? But let me now stop and give you the so what's. I want to give you about seven, that's a good biblical number. I want to give you seven biblical principles for parenting that I hope in some way will be helpful. Now, I've got to tell you that when I was a young pastor, I was kind of an expert in this area. And then something happened. Anybody want to guess? I had children, that's right. I think a lot of us are that way, you know, when we're young and we've got it all figured out and we know exactly what to do, and I'm never going to do this, and I'm always going to do that, you know. We've got it all figured out, and then we have children. And the plan runs off the track, and then they become teenagers, and we just want to go eat some dirt, you know. It's just, so I'm not telling you these things as an expert. I'm telling you these things as a fellow struggler. I'm telling you these things as some who's still on the journey. And I know that we've got people in all places today. We've got some that haven't even started the parent path yet. We've got some that are very early in it. We've got some who are in the teenage years. God bless you. And then we've got some like me that now we're dealing with grandkids. We're dealing with another generation that's coming along. But here are some principles, seven biblical principles that I hope will help you. Number one. Provide your children with an atmosphere for growth. Now, if you look at the passage, and I'll point this out to you over in chapter 2, verse 26. This is 1 Samuel 2, 26. It says, by contrast, the boy Samuel grew in stature and in favor with the Lord and with men. Does that sound familiar? Doesn't that sound a lot like Luke 2, 52, that Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men? Provide your children with an opportunity to grow. Now, that involves not just intellectually and not just emotionally and not just physically. That involves spiritually. Now, most parents are very determined to give their children opportunities to grow in many areas. I want them to have athletic prowess, so we're going to get them coaches. And we're going to get them on travel teams. And they're going to be an NFL or NBA star and make me and Mama rich one day. You know, you've got all of those hopes. And you want them to have every opportunity to get the most they can out of their athletic ability. And we want to get them an education. So we teach them to read, and we read to them. And we want them to be in a good school. And we encourage them to educationally to grow to be everything they can be. And emotionally, we want to teach them how to handle the issues that come in life and all of those things. But here's what some people do when it comes to spiritual things. Oh, I don't want to cram that down my child's throat. I don't want to turn them off to that. So I'm just gonna let them decide that on their own when they're old enough. Well, you didn't think that way about athletics. They might not like football. They might not like soccer or volleyball. You didn't think that way about athletics. You don't think that way about education. I don't want to turn them off to education. They might not ever go to college if I make them go to school when they're only 6 years old. I think I'll let them get a little older and decide that for themselves. You don't think that way about food. They might not like vegetables when they get older if I make them eat them now. I think I'll just let them eat candy. No, in every area of life, you want them to grow and you help them do that. So why would we come to the most important, the eternal part of life, and say, I don't want to push that down their throats? Give your children an opportunity to grow in every area of life. Number two, provide lofty ideals for your children. Now, children are either going to live up to or down to your expectations. And if what your children hear from you is, you will never amount to anything. You will never amount to anything. You are not going to accomplish anything. You are no good. If that's what you're telling your children, that's what they're going to live down to. But if you are telling your children that God has a plan for your life, God created you in His image, God loves you, He cares for you, He has a plan for you, and God's perfect plan for you is better than anything you can come up with on your own. If you will provide lofty ideals for your children, you can challenge them to live out God's best in them and through them. Here's the third thing. Recognize that your children are all different. You know, sibling rivalry started with family number one. With Adam and Eve and Cain and Abel, it was this sibling rivalry that led to murder. One brother killing another. Your children are different. And one of the worst things that we can do is start comparing those children, because this one does things this way and this one does something a different way. This one is a little bit smarter when it comes to the books. This one's a little bit more talented when it comes to art or whatever it might be. Understand that God created all of us differently. And it's an amazing thing that children can come from the same two parents, have the same DNA, and yet be very, very different. Let your children be who God created them to be. Number four, don't forget that discipline is not something that you do to your children. It's something that you do for your children. You are creating in your child a world of hurt. You are creating a crisis. And you are going to reap the benefits or the pain of it, as they are going to reap the pain of it, if you do not teach your children to have discipline. That is true in every part of life. And if you look at this passage, I said I didn't have time to go into all of this, but over in chapter 3, I told you that that Eli's sons were wicked men. Listen to what this verse says in chapter 3, verse 13. This is God speaking. He said, I told him that I'm going to judge his family forever because of the iniquity he knows about. His sons are defiling the sanctuary, and he has not stopped them. We not only have to teach our children to eat right and to study, we have to teach our children behavior. And if we do not teach our children behavior, in a culture like the one we're living in right now, we are creating disaster for them. Teach your children discipline. Number five, prepare your children for disappointment. Now, I know this goes against the grain in the world that we live in today, but folks, there are no participation trophies. Everybody doesn't get a prize for just showing up. Somebody's going to get a job, somebody's not going to get the job. Somebody's going to get a promotion, somebody's not going to get a promotion. And if we don't teach our children how to handle disappointment, when they get out of the confines of our world where we've protected them through everything that's happened, their legs are going to be knocked out from under them when they deal with the real world and real world problems. Here's a little poem I learned when I was young. The world will not adjust itself to suit your whims to the letter. Some things go wrong your whole life long, and the sooner you learn it, the better. Teach your children that disappointment is going to be a part of life, and they've got to learn how to handle that. Help them be emotionally stable. Here's the sixth thing. Teach your children to accept responsibility. Look, it's not always the teacher's fault and the coach's fault and the government's fault. And if that's the way you let your children grow up, always blaming something for somebody, let me tell you something. The day is going to come when they're going to say it's your fault. It's your fault. I mean, it's a basic premise of Scripture that we accept responsibility. We are responsible to God. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Teach your children to be responsible, to admit when they're wrong, to admit when they've done something they shouldn't have done, to be responsible as human beings. We're living in a culture where that's lost. And then here's the last thing. Enjoy your children while you can. Now, I do speak from experience about this. It will be over before you know it. Now, I know there are days when it seems as though you'll never get them out of diapers and walking, and there are days that they'll never, you know, be able to drive themselves where they want to go, and it just seems like those seasons of life are just never going to end, but I'm telling you that when you turn around about twice, it'll be over. And it's one of the greatest gifts that God gives us on earth, to look at those children. Now to look at those grandchildren, and I will tell you, young families, grandchildren are a whole lot more fun. If you could figure out a way to just skip that generation, you know, and go straight to the grandkids, that'd be terrific. Enjoy your children while you can. They're a gift that God has given to us. So God wants us to use what He's given to us, the families that we have, to thank Him for it. It's Mother's Day. Thank Him for your mom today, whether she's here or in heaven. Thank Him for your mom today. And make a commitment. God, help me as a parent or a grandparent, a husband, a wife. Help me to live out my faith, to truly let my relationship with You affect all that I am every day. God, help us to do that. Let's pray. Father, thank You on this Mother's Day. Thank You for those people that have impacted us so much. And thank You for the opportunity that we have to impact our families. And I pray for young parents here today that are just starting out. And I pray for those that are in the middle of the struggle right now. They're in some difficult times. And I pray for those that may be over at the other end of the spectrum. And now we're dealing with grandkids, some dealing with great-grandkids. It's a great gift that You've given to us. And we do not take it for granted. So, Lord, thank You. And help us to live out as Christian people what it means to be a parent, a spouse, a grandparent, as a follower of Jesus. Thank You, Lord, for all You do for us. Right now, Lord, I pray that if there's someone that's ready to become a part of this church, that this would be the day. If there's someone that's been wrestling with a spiritual commitment, someone has been wrestling with opening their heart to Christ, being saved. Someone's been wrestling with being baptized. If there's a spiritual decision that someone's been dealing with, I pray that this would be the day, this would be the time, and that that commitment would be made once and for all. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Ben and I are going to be here at the front. Jason's going to come lead us in a song. If there's any response you would make today, this is your opportunity to do it. Let's stand together. And if the Lord leads you, you come while we sing this song.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. And oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. And have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Just take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful, who will all our sorrow share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
If you have a spiritual decision you need to make, Pastor and I will be out in the foyer. We'd love to pray with you. We'd love to talk to you about joining our church or taking a next step of connection here. If you're a guest with us, we'd love to see you back there. I hope you have a wonderful Mother's Day with your family, and we'll see you soon. We're going to sing our way out of here.
Sing this chorus. How marvelous.
How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
God bless you guys. Have a great afternoon.